Good morning, everyone. We'll be continuing with module 3. So we started out with bus systems in your module 3, and then we later moved on to cache memory organizations. We saw different types of cache memory. One is direct memory, direct map, and then we have set associative mapping, and then the other extreme, which is fully associative mapping, right? And we also saw about how you can actually the mapping is done between your cache versus with respect to CPU. Your cache can be a physically addressed cache or virtually addressed cache. So we saw all these in the earlier class. Today we will move on to shared memory. Okay, so in memory, when it comes to memory, memory is like one big chunk, right? So we have like a huge array. It's if you think about it, it's just a one dimensional array of data bits. That's all. You're just storing series of data. It's all zeros and ones, right? 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, whatever it is, right? It's just series of your ones and zeros, and that are actually grouped in terms of bytes, or in most other systems, right? So we even combine the bytes, like 4 bytes we club together and we call it a word, okay? So most of the systems are either byte addressable or word addressable. So which means that you give that chunk, either one byte, or you give that one word, one address. Okay, so when you want to access that particular data, you are going to give that an address, so that using that address, you can either read or write into that location. Okay, if you think about it, it's just like a one dimensional series of data. That is not good. Okay, why? Because if you have like one dimensional series, then everything becomes sequential. Okay, so there has to be a way you can actually make this better. So what the architects have done is they have proposed an interleaved memory organization. Okay, so what is interleaving? So interleaving means you actually try to divide or segregate the memory into multiple subdivisions or different modules, rather than just have like one big tail. Okay, so instead of having like one series of bits, you're going to divide each into different module, and then you're going to access. Okay, how is that going to solve the problem? We will see. Okay, but how do you even divide? When you say you want to divide, there are two ways you can divide. So one is using a low order interleaving. The other one is a high order interleaving. Okay. Why are we doing this interleaving? So that you can do a pipelined memory access. Okay. So think about it. Always, like I mentioned in the earlier class also, right? Accessing memory is like going to a library and getting a book, rather than just getting a book from your bookshelf. Okay, so the comparison is that much. So whatever you can do in a few cycles from with using a cache, when there is a miss, you have to go to a library, that you have to spend like say 1 hour or 1.5 hours in commute, correct? So whatever you've been doing in a few cycles, you're going to wait for like say several cycles, from 20 to 100 cycles, okay, to get like one chunk of memory. Okay, so due to this, you want to make this memory access as much parallelizable as possible. Okay, you want to parallelize this memory access, and one way to do the parallelizing is through pipeline. Okay, the difference between parallel and pipeline is that when you have a multiple ports, right? So if your architecture supports reading like 10 memory words in one cycle, then it's parallel. But if you just have one memory port, then you cannot actually access all the modules at a given time, right? So in that case, you may have to do a pipeline. But in any case, you want to divide the memory and then access it. Okay. Now, how is it going to help? So it's going to look something like this with the GIF image, right? So you're not going to store everything in like one big series of data, but you're going to divide memory into different banks or modules. Okay. So there is going to be multiple modules. And if you want to access consecutive memory words, right? If you want to access consecutive bytes or consecutive words, then what you do is you store it in banks in a parallel fashion. Okay. So that the time it takes for you to read sequentially, you can actually do an overlap. You can do an overlapped memory access through the use of these multiple banks, and you can get better bandwidth. Okay, so that is the idea of memory interleaving. Okay, so now we've seen there are two things now. Okay, one is the words itself. Okay, so we are going to assume it's going to be word addressable. So each word, you're going to store it in memory and give that an address. However, you're going to group these words and then call that a module, like the bank here, right? So you're going to group these words in some way, and you're going to call each of them like a module. Okay, so now if you think about it, then if you have m modules, then again, everything is going to be a power of 2, right? So m equals to 2 power a. So that many modules if you have. And then if you have 2 power b words per module, then your total memory is going to be m times w, which is 2 power a plus b. Okay, let me hide this. How do I hide? Okay, now it's gone. Okay, so that's about the interleaved memory, right? So we saw what is interleaved memory, and there are two ways of doing this. It's one is low order and the other one is a high order. Okay, so here we are going to see how they are different. So the low order, so this one A, right, the top figure is the low order interleaving, and it's called as M-way interleaving because you have M modules. So each one, right? So each of these is a module. Okay. And in each of these modules, so M0 is a module, M1 is a module. So each one of this is a module. And in each memory module, you are going to have multiple words. Okay. So you're going to have your word 0 and then so on. So different words are going to be there. Okay, so now when you multiply the number of modules with number of words, that is your total memory size. Okay, now in low order interleaving, what you do is you have the address, right? The address, you're going to divide the address, you're going to divide the module based on the lower address. So let us say you have a memory, and that memory goes by this address, right? 0000. For now, we'll just assume the width is 4 bits, 0010 0011 0100 0101 0111 0111, and then you have 1000 and so on, right? You're going to have this. Now in if you take the low order interleaving, let us for now assume only two modules. Okay, so we will have only two modules. So module 0 and module 1. Okay, which means that how many bits do you need to segregate the module? You just need one bit. Okay, now in the case of, this is module 1. In the case of a lower order interleaving, you take the lower address, okay, lower bits to decide the module. Okay, so now if you divide the lower address, now based on bit 0, I am going to say whether it belongs to module 0 or module 1. Okay, now how am I going to say this? The interleaving is going to look like this. So this is how the actual memory is supposed to be, the logical memory, right? It's a series of your bits, right? So, and correspondingly, this is the address for that. But when you're actually physically storing it, how is it going to look like? It's going to look like this. So based on the last bit zero, okay, based on bit zero, I am going to decide which module it comes to. So that is my low order interleaving. Here in this case, it's going to be my 0, 0, 0, 0 is going to be here. Where will 0, 0, 0, 1 be? Based on this bit, I will put it here. Okay, 0, 0, 0, 1 will go here. And then 0, 0, 1, 0 will come here. And 0, 0, 1, 1 will come here. And so on. Now, if you think about it, you can just segregate the entire module and leave the last bit. Okay, if you leave the last bit, then the remaining bits is nothing but the number of words you have. So these are the different words you have. Okay, so it's going to be identical. 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1. The only differentiating factor is the last bit. Okay, the lower bit, lower order bit. That is why this memory is called as a low order interleaving. Okay, just the opposite of this, we will have higher order interleaving. In higher order interleaving, what we are going to do is, we are not going to segregate based on the least significant bit, but we will segregate based on the most significant bits. Okay, so we will just look at this one. Okay, so this, the uppermost bit. So how will it look like? So module 0 is going to be like this, and module 1. So what is going to be in module 0? 0, 0, 0, 0. And then 0, 0, 0, 1 will also be here. Why? Because you're just going to look at the most significant bit and then you're going to order. So this is going to go all the way to 0, 1, 1, 1, correct? And then the moment you get 1, 0, 0, 0, you'll put it in module 1 and then 1, 0, 0, 1 and so on. Okay, finally 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay, now the differentiating factor is going to be the highest bit or higher bits. Okay, in this case, we have only two modules. So with one bit, you can just differentiate. With just the highest bit, you can differentiate. But if you have multiple modules, right? If you have modules, like if you have four modules, then you need to take two bits. Okay, you have to take the two upper bits. Clear, everyone? So this is how you make the higher order interleaving. Now, there are these two ways available to us. Okay, each one has its own advantage and disadvantage. Okay, but let us first understand what is this lower order interleaving and higher order interleaving. Okay, low order interleaving means based on the lower bits, you divide the modules. Based on higher order interleaving means based on the higher bits, you do the interleaving. So if you look at the architecture, it's going to look like this, right? So for lower order interleaving, you're going to have the sequence of memory in this fashion. Okay. So it's going to go all the way like this, and then the next one is going to come here and it's going to go all the way like this. Okay, so the memory is going to be interleaved this way. Okay, if you want to access consecutive memory words, you should access it from consecutive modules. Okay, but on the other hand, if you have higher order interleaving, it is going to get stored in this order. Okay, so 0, 1, 2, 3 and so on. And then once this is done, you will go to the next one. Okay, so it's going to get stored in this order. Understood? So lower order interleaving is going to get stored in this fashion, horizontal fashion, and then higher order interleaving is going to go in this vertical fashion. Clear, everyone? Any questions? Okay. So now, which brings us to one concept called as multi-way interleaving. Okay. So in this, we are going to do a pipelined access. When you want to do a pipelined access, there is going to be two things. Okay. If you think of your CPU pipeline, we understood two terms, right? One is latency and the second one is bandwidth. When you say latency is the time it takes for the pipe to get full. Okay, the first instruction to complete. That will be the latency. In general, it will be as big as your number of stages in your pipeline. Similarly, here also you have two different, and bandwidth is nothing but how often you get, right? It's every cycle you will get one instruction getting committed. So that will be your bandwidth, correct? IPC. That's your bandwidth. So coming to pipeline in memory, you have two things. So it's called a major cycle and a minor cycle. And major cycle is nothing but if you look at this interleavings, again, this is a lower order interleaving we have. If you consider this one, right? When you want to access consecutive words, which means since it's a lower order interleaving, you're going to access it in this fashion, correct? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 in this fashion. Now, if that is the case, then what you will have? So in this particular example, we have 8 modules and 8 words. Okay. So now the words, this is the module. Okay. So this is module 0, which is the vertical part, and here this is your words, consecutive words, and if you want to access these consecutive words, you're going to have these two, like major cycle and minor cycle. How do you access this? When you access one particular word, that one particular word in one cycle, let us say you have the first cycle, right? The first cycle you're requesting for word 0. Now that as the word is getting processed, so the major cycle means the time it takes for this word to complete. Okay, the time you start you place the request and when the word is actually available for you, so that is denoted by theta, and that is called as a major cycle. Okay, this is similar to the latency we saw in pipeline, correct? Again, in the second, if you think about it, the number of cycles for completion of one word is not going to be one, correct? So memory access takes a long time. This could be like several cycles. It could be like say 10 cycles or something. Okay, but in every cycle we may have some memory request, correct? In cycle 1 you made a request. In cycle 2 you will make one more request. Okay. And this is being processed, and this is being done by module 0, and this is being done by module 1. Okay, so there is not going to be any conflict. Module 0 is preparing your word 0, and module 1 is preparing your module 1. Okay, and this is also going to take 10 cycles. Okay, but after you wait for 10 cycles, every other cycle you are going to get the word out. Okay. It's very similar to your pipelining. This is pipelining in your memory. Okay, every single cycle after your major cycle, you are going to get one word out because you are overlapping. And how are you able to overlap? You are able to overlap because you have multiple modules. Okay, and there is no conflict between the modules. So the problem will come only if you have, if you request word 0 and word 8. If you request word 0 and word 8, then module 0 cannot process two at a time. Then you have to wait for some time. Okay. But assuming that most of the memory access will be sequential, so you just follow this and you will have like a nice pipeline memory. Okay. That's about your multi-way interleaving. Any questions on this, guys? Okay, so we were talking about the bandwidth, right? So now what is the bandwidth? So now if you just have one module, then your bandwidth is one. Okay, so you will get like one word in a given given request, given cycle. Okay, and if you have m modules, then the upper bound is m. Maximum how much can you get in parallel? M, correct? But your actual effective bandwidth should be between this lower and upper bound. Between 1 and m, it's there. And so one scientist, Hellerman, so he estimated the effective bandwidth to be somewhat approximated to square root of m. Okay. And T1 is the effective access time. And that effective access time is given by this equation here. Okay. here when your n tends to be tends to infinite, which means if it's a very long vector, you just want to access sequentially from memory address 0 all the way to the end of the memory, then your effective access time is going to be tau. What is tau? Tau is your minor access time, right? We saw two access time. One is major access time and the other one is minor access time. Minor access time is nothing but once your pipeline kicks in, you're going to get one in every minor access time, you're going to get one memory access, correct? So that is your tau. And when n is just one, then it's nothing but your theta. This is your major access time, which means if you just want to access one word of memory, it is going to get it's going to take theta, right? That's your time. So this is the worst and best case time or effective time. Now again, there is something called as fault tolerance. Okay, every component in your computer can go faulty. Okay, you always have to keep this in mind, especially when it comes to memory. There could be faulty memory. Okay, so it's easier to isolate memory, a faulty memory in higher order interleaving. Why is that? It's because you can say, if you want to access, let us say the region between say 10 and 15 addresses, right? Address 10 and 15 are corrupted. So in higher memory module, what you can simply say is higher module goes this way, right? You're going to store the memory in this fashion. Okay, so it's going to be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 like that. So 10 to 15 could be somewhere here. You can just say, okay, don't access this module. This module is faulty. Okay, you can mark this module as faulty and use all the other modules. But in lower order interleaving, that is not possible because you're going to store in horizontal fashion. So 10 to 15 is going to look like this, right? 10, 11, 12. 13, it's going to be like this. So each one will belong to one module. So you have to have another mechanism to somehow track this. Okay, so it's coming to fault tolerance, it's easy to do that in higher order interleaving. But for all other practical purposes, lower order interleaving is very good because it's easier to put it in this pipeline fashion. Any questions on this, guys? Okay. Now, let's refresh some of the memory allocation schemes. I think this one you must have already studied in either computer organization or in your operating systems course. First is memory swapping. So memory swapping is means you're just going to swap in and out the memory, okay, from disk. So you're going to bring a particular sector or a block from your disk or pages from your disk all the way to your memory, okay, and you may have to replace it. Okay, so there's going to be a swap. In most operating systems you have a swap space, especially if you have installed Linux, right? If any of you have experience installing or using a Linux system, you have something called as a swap space, which is there in almost all operating system, but Linux explicitly allows you to configure that. So based on the swaps, generally you have this 2x or 4x times your RAM. That's what you allocate for swap space. And that's dedicated space for you to swap in and out of your main memory. Okay, so you just, it's like a buffer in your disk actually. And coming to allocation, so there could be a preemptive, a non-preemptive allocation, which means that once your process has been allocated memory, that process cannot be preempted by the operating system, correct? So you cannot evict that out of memory. And in contrast to that, you have preemptive allocation where you might have the process being interrupted, and then you actually swap out the process. You actually evict that region of the memory back to disk, and you bring in some other process, okay, even before the process finishes. And there's also something called as thrashing. So thrashing is nothing but your operating system has come to a state where it's doing this swapping in and swapping out most of the time rather than actually spending time in executing the process. This will typically happen only for a preemptive allocation, right? So when you have a preemptive process, preemptive scheduling, then what might happen is you will get one process interrupting the other, let us say process 1 is interrupting process 0, then process 0 will be thrown to the disk. Now immediately process 0 is not a nice guy. Okay, process 0 is going to come back and then say, hey, why did you evict me? I want to execute. And operating system being the nice guy, it's going to say, hey, okay, fine, let's preempt. We have preemptive allocation, right? So let's preempt you. And then process 0 will preempt process 1 now. Again, process 1 will have its revenge. Okay, so process 0 and process 1 are just going to compete with each other, and rather than focusing on the actual work, just like most politicians, right? We only try to blame the other guys, saving our own seat. Nobody cares about the development of the nation, correct? That's how most politicians in the world are. So that's exactly what will happen in thrashing. Okay, you will only, ironically, thrashing also happens in debates. So anyway, the thrashing here means you just spend a lot of time in swapping in and swapping out and not the actual execution. And there's something called as a local allocation, and there's something called as a global allocation. Local allocation is the memory allocation only for that particular process, and global allocation is a shared data region. Okay, coming back to the swapping systems. So you have swap device. Okay, a device is nothing but your disk memory here, where, and then you actually set aside one region of your device and say, okay, this particular region of my device is going to act for as a swapping device, and in that you set aside a given memory, and that is going to be your swap space. Okay, and we also saw demand paging. We saw demand paging in caches also, right? So same thing, not in caches, even before the caches we saw some memory schemes. So where we saw demand paging, where you bring in the page from your disk to your main memory, and then you actually evict something. So there's a least recently used, and there are several algorithms to do that. And hybrid memory systems. So hybrid memory system, you have more than one of these to actually configure. Okay, so there is not like one particular way to do this memory. So you'll have multiple combinations of these properties that actually makes your current memory systems. Okay, so with that we come to conclusion of this particular topic. So let's have like a quick refresher. So let me check your understanding. So let's have somebody, Shubham, can you point to someone? Suhas. Hey, always when you point to somebody, right, like make sure you point to someone who, I mean, the least recently used, right? So we'll follow that algorithm. Hey Suhas, can you try to answer this quiz question? Figure A, which interleaving is it? Is it higher order interleaving or lower order interleaving? Why didn't you know? Can you check, help, get help from your friend? Shiva Prasad, please help Suhas. I'm sorry. Maybe. We don't want maybes. We want. Why are you not sure? Ask your friend. Sai Krishna, please help Shiva Prasad and Suhas. Okay, good, nice. Ask your friend, get help. Sai, get help. Shreyas, please help Sai, Shivaprasad, and Suhas. Why is it higher order? Ah, good, nice. Okay, so you have the differentiator in the uppermost bit. Okay, so that makes this higher order. So which means your figure B is lower order. Very good. Thanks, Shreyas. Did you understand, Sai? What did you understand? No, I didn't understand. No, that's why I'm asking you. You don't need history. That's why I'm asking you, how much have you understood? Just check this, no? Just look at these figures. I have marked it. What do you understand by this? Ah, that's all. Okay. Yeah. And do you know what is M0, M1? Sai. Okay. So see what we discussed is memory, instead of storing it in like one sequential array, we thought we will divide that memory into multiple modules. Okay, so this is module 0 and this is module 1. Okay, and how you want to segregate the bits, we decide based on the upper bit or lower bit. Okay, so that's what we discussed. Got it? Okay, all right. Great, let's move on to the next topic. So this is the last topic in your chapter. This is sequential and weak consistency models. Okay. It's a bit dry, but try to keep your attention. Okay. And as I said, these are the topics that can make or break your exams. Okay. So please, please be attentive. Please ask questions. Okay. Be attentive. Okay. Consistency model. So when we talk about memory, memory has to be consistent. What do you mean by that? Memory inconsistency. When you say memory is not consistent, it means that when memory access order differs from the program execution order. Okay, so what does it mean? It means, let us say you're doing this load A, okay, into R1, and then you're going to do add R2 comma R2 comma R1. Okay, you're going to do R2 plus R1. You're going to give it to R2, okay? But before that, you're going to load A into R1. Let us say A equals to 5 here, something. Okay, we don't care. But now, if this load does not happen before this add, then there is a problem. Okay, then this is not consistent. Why? Because somewhere here, your R1 could be some 0 or something, we don't know. Like R1 could be 10 or whatever, right? But let us say this load does not happen, but your add is happening. If load does not happen before add, then you will be adding the wrong value, correct? R1 will have 10 instead of 5. Now that is inconsistent. You want your memory to be consistent. Okay? There is the most stringent one is to have a sequential consistency, which means that your memory accesses both instruction and data are consistent with the program execution order. It's very straightforward, right? So like we saw in that example, as long as you maintain the program execution order, you will maintain memory. Okay, you will have memory consistency. Okay, so that's called your sequential consistency. Now some of the consistency issues here, okay, so that deals with memory model. which is when you have a shared memory system by processors. Okay, and you also need to have like a compromise between a strong model with a weak model. Okay, and we will see more on this. Why do you need a strong model and why do you need a weaker model? And we need to keep in mind that whatever we are talking about is related to these three operations: load, store, and swap. Okay, only these three operations deal with memory, correct? We are assuming like more like a RISC kind of architecture where loading means you load some data from your memory to register. Okay, and in store, you are going to store the register value back to memory, and swap is just doing both. Okay, you're just going to swap the value from memory to register and that register to the same memory location. Okay, so that's these are the three operations pertaining to memory. All other operations like add, subtract, multiply, compare, everything else you assume that you're not going to use memory but only use registers. Okay. Come to another concept called event ordering. Okay, this event ordering is going to declare whether a given memory event is legal or not legal. Okay, so this will run parallelly to your program order. So program order is the order in which your memory access occurs in a program. That order, we can also have something called as like an event order, where you don't have to go through the program order but still maintain consistency. Okay, where you have like a different event ordering. Like for example, if there is no dependency, right? Like let us say you have you're loading to R1A, but you're doing add. Here you're going to do R2, R3, R4. Okay, add R3 and R4, put it in R2. Now here the program order should be like this: load should come before, add should come after. But event ordering need not be like that, right? Your add can actually run independently of your load because there is no dependency. So there are two different concepts here: event ordering and program ordering. Okay. So program order, if you take a sequential processor or a serial processor, your program order is going to follow this pattern. Okay, these are the instructions in your instruction memory. Now you're going to follow this order. Now when it comes to multiprocessor systems, this is your program order. Okay, so actually it's the other way around. This is instruction 1, instruction 2, and it goes this way. And even here it's going to be instruction 1, instruction 2. This is your program order. Okay, but your event order need not be sequential, which means that it need not be your I1, I2, I3, and then after that only you do J1, J2, J3. It need not be like that. You can do I1 and then you can do J1. Okay, or it can be I1, I2, J1, J2. It can be anything, right? As long as you maintain some kind of consistency. Okay, so this is the two different things we need to understand. Now there are some primitive operations. Okay, we need to understand when it comes to memory consistency. One is a load. Okay, a load by a processor PI is considered to be performed with respect to PK. PK is another processor. With respect to PK, so for PK, if I am PK, I am going to assume that PI's load is performed or it is done when I issue a store to the same location. Okay, let us say that your PI has done a load to location A, and PK is doing a store to A. Now I am doing a store after my PI has done the load, so there is going to be some delta time in between. Okay, if there is some delta time enough so that my store is not going to affect this guy's load, then this means that PI's load is performed. Okay, so there's not going to be any issue. Similarly, a store by PE is considered performed when PK is going to do a load to the same address and there is no issue. Okay. And finally, there is going to be a globally performed where when it means that all the other processors can do the store when the load is complete by PI. Okay. So these three things we need to keep in mind. So we will just graphically represent the same things here. The first thing is your load. Okay. A load is performed by PI. So PI has done a load here. Okay. And PK is doing a store to the same location. And as long as this load is done and you give enough time is given so that this load is done and there is not going to be any issues after which you are going to do the store. Okay. Then this load is called performed. It's performed by PI, or in other words, it is completed. Similarly, you have it for store. Okay. A store is performed by PI when you can do a load without affecting the store. And third one is a global load. Okay. A globally performed by PI. Okay. A globally performed load is when your PI has done a load and everyone else can do a store with respect to this PI. Okay. It's not going to affect this load. So then it means that your load is globally performed. Understood? So just get to know these terms. Okay. Now we have to talk about the correctness and predictability. Okay. When it comes to MIMD systems, it becomes a lot more complex. Why? Because the order of execution is not fixed. Okay. Multiple instruction, multiple data. And if you have like out of order execution, then the order of execution is not fixed. Now, you don't have to follow the program order. In the earlier example I showed, right? Your add and load, if there is no dependency, then you can actually change the order depending on like which functional unit is free and which processor is free. You can actually do these kind of shuffling of this instruction as long as it is consistent. Okay. You may get better performance then. And non-atomic and multiple copies of same data. Some of these instructions are non-atomic. Okay. And when you have multiple copies of the same data, then you can do things in parallel. Okay. You can still get better performance. Okay. So which brings us to different orders of execution. Okay. So you can actually have different ways in which you can do this ordering. Consider this example. So you have three processors, processor one, processor two, processor three. Okay. And you have these instructions A, B in processor one, C, D in processor two, and E, F in processor three. Okay. So now your output, what is going to be your output? Processor one is going to give you output BC. Okay. Print BC. Processor 2 is going to give you the output print AC, and processor 3 is going to give you the output AB. Okay. Now, depending on how you order this, you are going to get different results. Okay. If you put the results as a tuple of 6 in size, then if you execute the program in this order, A, B, C, D, E, F, which means that you're going to follow a program or a sequential program order, processor 1 doing first, processor 2 doing next, and processor 3 doing last. Okay. You go this order, A, B first, and then C, D, and then you go E, F. If you do this in this order, the output is going to be like this, 0, 0, 1, 0, and then 1, 1. Okay. You're going to print B, C here, right? So initially you assume A equals to 0, B equals to 0, and C equals to 0. Okay. Now, A, when you do this order, A will become 1 now. Okay. And then your B and C, you're printing B and C. So your output is 0, 0. Then you're going to have B equals to 1. Now, if you print AC, your A is already 1, no? 1, 0, right? You will print 1, 0. Then if you go to processor 3, you make C equals to 1. Now C, you make it as 1. You print AB. A and B are 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay. So that's why you have this 0, 0, 1, 0, and 1, 1. Okay. Now, if you follow a different program order, let us say you're going to follow this order, right? Processor 1 doing A, and then processor 2 executing its first instruction, which is C, and then processor 3 executing its first instruction, E. Okay, so then the program order will become A, C, E, B, D, F. If that is the case, then you will have 111111 as your output. Okay, you can also do out of order, out of order execution. Now, if you do this, right, B, D, F, E, A, C, then you will get all zeros. Now, you think about it, there are 6 factorial different interleavings possible. Okay, 720 for just these two instructions in each of these processors. You get 720 possible interleavings. And out of the 720, 90 of them are in program order. Okay, so if they preserve program order. Okay, so we need to now have some kind of interleaving here and have some kind of a consistency model that will give us the correct result, okay, or which will not break the memory consistency. Any questions? Okay. Atomicity. A program order preserves an uniform observation sequence by all process. Okay, a program order is preserved. It means it is atomic. In other words, what we mean by this is that, so when you have a program order P1, right, and you have instruction 1, instruction 2, instruction 3, and if nobody can break this, correct, so once P1 starts, you're going to do I1, you're going to do I2, you're going to do I3, which means that nobody can break you in between. So this is atomic. Okay. Out of order program execution, obviously it is non-atomic. Why? Because you have program 1, you have program 2, you have instruction 1, instruction 2, instruction 3 here, and then you have another instruction J1, J2, J3 here. J and I look the same. Okay, so now you may say, I will do I1 first and then J1 next, and then I2 next and then J2 next. Okay, so if this is the order in which you're doing it, then it may not be the program order, or you can actually do I1, I3, I2 also. If that is the case, then it is totally out of order execution. That is non-atomic. Okay, you may not have atomic operations here. So out of order program, we still allow out of order program executed for, and there is also non-uniform accesses of memory. We have to keep in mind that it may sound simple to have atomic operations, but it's very, very conservative. So we have to allow out of order execution, and also there is non-uniform accesses, right? We saw about UMA and NUMA memory. So even NUMA memory model, if we have, we need to support that. Okay, so in order to do that, we have to give support for these systems. So in atomic systems, the ordering is it's strongly ordered, and it's very, very conservative. And in non-atomic systems, it's not strongly ordered. So we should support this weak ordering. Okay, even with a weak ordering, we should have the memory in a consistent way. Okay, so the idea is, when you want to debate whether you want strong consistency model or weak consistency model, we need to check what kind of system we have. If the system is completely atomic, then strong consistency model will hold. But if the system, which in most case, right, may not be atomic, so in that case, you will have to support your weak consistency model. Coming to strong consistency model, right, we will just see a sequential consistency model. In this, you have, like we saw earlier, right, load, store, and swaps. So they are the ones who are going to access your memory, correct? There are two definitions to define this model. The first one is called Lamport's definition. So here the conditions are, before a load is allowed, okay, all other previous loads must be globally performed, and all previous stores must be performed with all processors. Okay, we saw what is globally performed and what is performed, correct? So now what they are saying is, when you have a load, then when this processor is executing a load, then all other processors who are going to access this location is going to perform their loads and stores. Okay. And similarly, if you before a particular store, then all other processors' loads and stores must be performed. So if you guarantee these two, then you will have a consistent model. Okay, so that's your Lamport's definition. It's a very broad and very high level definition. Okay, now we have one more definition which was refined by Sindhu, Freylong and Seeclaw. So in this one, they have refined Lamport's model and they have come up with this axioms. So first one is, your load always returns the value returned by the latest store. Okay, load should get the latest store value. The second one is, your memory order should be, your memory order is nothing but your total binary order of your loads and stores. If you think about it, your memory is nothing but, it's just a sequence of your loads and stores, right? The order in which your loads and stores are happening, that's exactly what your memory model is. Okay, so that memory order should be consistent with your loads and store order. Now, if two operations appear in a program order, then you have the same memory order. Okay, that's very obvious. If you have a program order, if you follow the program order, you will also follow the memory order. Then your swap operation should be atomic. What is swap? We saw swap, right? Swap means you do a load and you do a store. Okay, here you're doing load, you're loading, let us say A to R1, and then you will do whatever was there earlier, right? That R1, you will store it in the same location A. Okay, so you will have a temporary variable somewhere here. So the value of R1 will go to A, the value of A will go to R1. Now, this should not be interleaved. Okay, this should not be preempted. Okay, this has to be atomic. Okay, because this is a swap operation. So swap, even though it's one operation, it has multiple sub operations in it. Okay, so that has to be atomic. And all stores and swaps must eventually terminate. Okay, we shouldn't have indefinite stores and swaps. Okay, so assuming all this, we will have like a very consistent or like a very strong consistency model. But there are also weak consistency models. Okay, the strong consistency model is it's sequential. All sequential models are strongly consistent. But we also support levels of weak consistency. Okay, there are two models that are considered. So first one is, it's a DSB model. It stands for Du Bois, Skerewich and Briggs. Okay, so these are the authors who proposed this. And the other one is a TSO model, which is total store order model. Okay, so let us quickly see what these are. In a DSB model, very simply put, it depends on synchronization. Okay, in your operating systems, you would have heard of your semaphores, right? Semaphores, and also you have these locks, synchronizations and locks, correct? So you use something like that here. You always assume that all synchronization accesses must be performed before a load and store. Okay. So when you're doing a load or a store operation, you make sure that before you do load and store, there is some synchronization that happened. It's going to look like this. Okay. All the operations are going to be like this. When you're, these are all like your load operations, right? By each processor. Before this, you should have like a synchronization. Okay. So there is a synchronization point before you do any load store operation. And after you do synchronization, after you do load and store, then you also have another synchronization point. Okay. So all previous load and store access must be performed before a synchronization access is allowed to perform with respect to any other processor. Okay. So before a synchronization So here, before a synchronization, you should have performed all the loads and stores. And before you do all the loads and stores, you have performed a synchronization operation. So it's always going to look like this. Your program flow is going to look like this. Okay, so these are the synchronization points, and you have your loads and stores. So it's always interleaved like that. Okay, the other model is TSO model, total store ordering. In this, you only focus on stores. Okay, you focus on your store operation, and then you come up with this. Load returns the latest store result. Okay, as long as my load returns latest store, I am good. The other one is my memory order is a total binary of all binary operation of all your store operations. Even previously we considered load and store, right? So if you just consider store itself, because store is the only operation that is going to modify the memory. Okay, load is just going to read from the memory, but store is the operation that is going to modify your memory. So you consider only store. What you do is you actually have a FIFO buffer for all these processors, and you're going to store all the, I mean, you're going to put all the store operations in a queue. Okay, and then which will ensure that your store operations are consistent. They do sequentially with respect to every processor. Okay, then you automatically will follow the program order. Okay, if you follow the store order, then you also program the program order, which in turn you follow the memory order as well. And swap is again atomic. As long as you assume swap is atomic, it's fine. And again, all stores and swap must eventually terminate. Okay, so with this, we come to the end of your module. So let us just have like a quick refresher, right? So which of the following is preferred in a multiprocessor environment? Whether it's a strong consistency model or weak consistency model, or both or none. So the answer here is both. Okay. Why? Because a strong consistency model is suitable only if my architecture supports atomic operations. But there are a lot of non-atomic architectures, right? Architecture that supports non-atomic operations. So for that, weak consistency model is preferred. Okay. So as you've seen earlier, so both A and B are needed. Okay. Any questions, guys? Okay, if not, we are done. Alright, you can give your attendance and feel free to drop. Thank you, guys.